I originally picked up my first set of drumsticks maybe in fifth grade. I got involved in the school band, but while I was doing so, I was just a snare drummer. And the kid that was two grades older than me was playing the entire trap kit. So I was up there with my little single drum and I turned around watching him play the whole thing and I was like, oh hell no, I'm not doing this anymore. Years later, I went to a friend's house and his parents were away on vacation, so boys do what young teenage boys do, which is throw a kegger. And there was a drum set down there and the Bee Gees record just come out. So I sat behind the drums while we were getting ready for the party and I just started playing along with Staying Alive, and it just, he's like, how are you doing that? I'm like, I don't know. And I ended up buying that drum set for $65 and that's where it all started. I didn't really want to go to college, so my dad said to me, well, if you want to go to college, we'll send you to college. If there's anything else you want, let me know. And I have a feeling I know what it is. So they bought me a brand new drum set, a really big, nice drum set. Continued to play from there, and by the time I was 17, 18 years old, I was already playing all over from here to Florida. Hooked up with a little band, and away I went. I started locally, like everybody does, with some of the corner bars, you know, where you get $200 for 17 guys in the band kind of thing, and you know, everybody makes $15. But that's what you have to do, and that's the best place to do it. I was in another band called the Armadillos that played here locally, and both of us had just recently written new records. We were managed by the same company, so both bands were going down to CBGB's and Arlene's Grocer and all that stuff in New York and playing these original shows for record labels. And eventually Fuel ended up grabbing a deal from Sony. And then I guess when they came back and get ready to tour, the drummer that was originally in the band at the time had some ill will with all that going on. And I had received a phone call to join the band, which the first time I turned it down, because I wanted to stay with the band I was with because they were like my bros, you know? So I'm like, I can't bail on the boys, you know? I feel like I'm just giving up. And basically after several phone calls from the management company, who were my friends, they were like, Kevin, what are you thinking? Why are you being so thick? And I said, I'm not trying to be thick. I'm just trying to make it all make sense to me because I feel like I'm abandoning my guys that I've been in the trenches with. So, and it's, you know, it was really an emotional time for me. And it was horrible. And, in my head, I was like, well, it's kind of like if I had two lottery tickets, one won, one might win, which one do you want? And I've been, at that point, playing in cover bands for 25 years in the trenches, so I went, I guess it was kind of an audition, but it didn't go long. Like, we were in there, we played a few songs, and they were like, okay, we'll give you a call, and I got the phone call. They're like, hey, man, your first gig's next week at CBGB's in front of the record label with no rehearsal. So whatever I learned, that was it. And so there's the president of the record label sitting as close as you are, her name was Polly Anthony, and she was unbelievably a huge supporter of the band. And then sitting aside of her was Brendan O'Brien, who was one of the biggest producers in the planet at the time. And I'm like, oh my God, this is not happening. Like, they are right at the edge of the stage here. And they made it like a seating thing, you know, they pulled chairs and tables and that was it. We went up, but we did the show and it kicked butt and away I went. You know, we toured so much the first 2 years, I was home 14 days. And that included everywhere in the United States and Australia and New Zealand and Europe and all that stuff. So over the period of those years that we were together, we were to Australia 5 times, New Zealand 4 times, all through Europe 3 times. And I saw every dumpster in the United States about 6 times. Everybody says, "Why would you say that?" Like, because the buses always park in the alley, and when you walk out, that's where the dumpsters are. Every night was a special moment, and I was grateful to be there. Like every, because every night is so different. When the lights drop and the crowd goes ballistic, and you get out and you're up there playing, and you're watching thousands of people mouthing every word to every song you're playing. It's just, the dynamic is just this high every night. You're like, holy cow. Being on tour with Aerosmith, that didn't suck. That was amazing. So that's definitely a highlight. I mean, we played with everyone that was on the radio at the time when it was lit, Eve 6, Korn, Limp Bizkit. Like, you are always on those festivals. You played with everyone. Going back to Aerosmith, when they personally asked us to be their main support, that was like mind-blowing. Like, holy cow, we're going out with Aerosmith. And that was about a year and a half out of those years, like 3 months here, 3 months here, 3 months there, touring all over the place. We did a HFS festival in DC, and that was 65,000 people, and that was just as high as you can get. Like, you want to walk out there and all you see is a jam-packed football stadium just with people smashed from the field, and every seat was full, and you're like, wow, this is cool. When you set out to be a full-time musician and you want to make records and play music, I was just really lucky enough to do what I wanted to do. And actually met the goal in my head when I bought that little $65 drum set. And I'm like, I want to be a rock star, you know? And there I was, like, you know, my buddies call me like, dude, I just watched your video on MTV. And you're like, you know, I kind of get embarrassed. Oh, that's cool, right? You know, like, I don't know. It was just awesome. We did Jay Leno. We did Conan O'Brien, Sharon Osbourne's show, David, you know, did I say David Letterman? Did I mention David Letterman? So, all the big TV shows at the time, we were on every one of them every late night. We did some red carpet stuff, you know, where we wrote the song track for the movie Godzilla, the movie Daredevil. We did Scream 3. Brett and I were really close. He actually lived in my house with me, myself and my wife, for the first record and a half, maybe. And then, he branched off after we started actually getting paid to do what we were doing. It's kind of like the mob, you know. You can't really, I'm not going to do my laundry publicly. I'll just say that myself and an individual just were not seeing eye to eye after years of being in the band, and I wanted to do things one way, and I felt I deserved that right to do things a certain way, you know, especially when it came to drumming, because that's what I was hired for. So I felt my knowledge and my profession as holding that seat, then maybe I should get a lot of latitude on, you know, if he's hearing one thing and I'm like, yeah, I know, but, you know, it feels cooler if I do this as a drummer, because if you program things on a keyboard or he's playing on the synthesizer, you know, it may sound cool on a recording, but it doesn't necessarily translate to a drummer playing it the way it would be played. So it just be a matter, I mean, I always did what I was asked to do, but I just felt I should have had a little more latitude in my playing. You know, we hadn't all talked for a couple of years, and, you know, they let some things pass and cool down, but quite frequently now, Brett and I text each other. I go out to a Sea of Fuel show, jump on stage with him. And Carl and I, we met up in Vegas. I was there doing some stuff, and we met up, had dinner, and talked it out, a little laughing, a little crying, a little more crying than laughing. And now we text each other quite frequently or call each other on the phone and just chew the fat. And that's cool. I recently started a new project called Kevin Miller's Smashed. You can look us up on Facebook under Kevin Miller's Smashed. It is a better than average cover situation because all the players are National Act level guys. So it's not like you would see at a normal club act because it's way up here. I'm very happy to have everybody that's in my band. We just recently took on a female singer. Her name is Ash, and she slays. So now we'll be adding to the rock repertoire because we do everything from Boston and Styx and Kansas and the Cars and David Bowie and Casey and the Sunshine Band. We do Kool and the Gang. So it's a big gamut of music. There's six people in the band. Everyone sings lead vocals. My one guitar player plays drums as well. And he comes back and I come out front, so we kind of switch. So I do some singing and Ash will be adding a lot of stuff with her as far as Lady Gaga and Blondie and No Doubt and Christina Aguilera and some Paramore. So it's basically just a really cool dance rock party band, but it's all the hits of the hits. So it's very recognizable. And we'd be playing from Pennsylvania to Florida to, we have dates in Pittsburgh, we have dates in Lake George, New York. We're all over the place. So look for us at a town near you.